Nearly 7 decades after the signing of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the international system has evolved in many ways. However, its effectiveness in protecting the world's most vulnerable and marginalized remains a challenge. Human rights organizations are adopting multiple strategies and creating new alliances to make the system relevant and respond to the challenges.
The biggest challenge we're facing now is clearly demonic politics, this populist brand of politics where illiberal democracies are problematizing the human rights framework and the rule of law. We're seeing it across the globe, and these leaders are watching one another and following one another in a downward trajectory where they're saying, you know, that in a populist response, that the human rights framework is the problem. And by taking away the rule of law and civil liberties, they're undermining equality. They're creating this discriminatory framework, this discriminatory climate within which human rights violations can thrive. And the human rights movement isn't agile enough or isn't responding urgently enough in a way that's joined up to be able to really demonstrate how the human rights framework and the rule of law have to be the solution right now.
Even, I think, as a women's rights organization, when we look at the UN human rights system and the long history and the important role that system has played for establishing women's rights as human rights, there's so much frustration with how that system has been weakened and undermined, and some questioning, you know, do we stay there? Do we go somewhere else? Where else is there? Where we've come to is that we have to hold on to that system. It is the multilateral space that we have. But perhaps the balance of our energies is really shifting towards the more movement engagement, mobilizing, building collective power, and lifting up the proposals, the new realities, the kind of more just ways of being that we see different social movements engaging in and articulating together, that we hope in turn can eventually help to strengthen the formal system itself.
You cannot make an international, a multilateral body having two countries that are responsible. You need several countries having leadership in human rights. So we are trying to create leaderships in human rights from the South. And it doesn't happen from the decision of the government. It only happens if there's pressure on them to change their position.
Our presence in Geneva, we always saw it as a kind of as a vehicle, not as an end itself, but a vehicle to, on the one hand, to access directly to the information and bring it back to our constituency, our allies in Argentina and in the region. And on the other hand, bringing to Geneva different issues from our allies, our work, our agenda.
There is another layer that is related to how these national organizations move to the global level to strengthen the global system. For example, when in the case of the Inter-American human rights system, and when the Inter-American human rights system is under attack by, you know, Latin American countries, you know, what's the role of national organizations in Latin America coming out to support the system in a much more meaningful way, and not only in terms of their own governments, but in the, throughout the region? So what we saw, for example, in this case, is that the collaboration among key Latin American national organizations supporting the system was critical to really shift the terms of the conversation.
We've been able to make our contribution to setting the agenda on different fields. One is drug policy. Colombia has been, of course, as everyone knows, a node in the drug business in historical terms, but it's also been a source of innovation on how to approach the issue of the drug trade and drug policy. We early on civil society first and then the government more recently advocated for a public health approach to drug and drug consumption, as opposed to a criminal system approach to that issue. Over the years, we were able to influence spaces like UNGAS, the UN Conference on Drugs, and also regional and national bodies and governments and courts that were deciding on laws, on policies, on cases.
We are completely aware of a large number of people in the population who feel we don't speak for them and that we don't represent them. So the challenge for us, I think, has got to be getting more evidence that then supports the positions that we take.
We need to still be, number one, via the human rights framework, asking questions about the systems that are producing inequality, that are producing impoverishment, that are producing climate change, that are leading to repression when groups start to demand their rights. We need to be asking more systemic structural conditions questions and really building an analysis around some of those issues. And in addition to that, we actually need to be putting forward alternatives for how the world could look different.